Hi dear students, so today we'll discuss the questions of surgery asked in the FMGE July 23 exam. Okay, so this all the questions which I have, these are basically the recall based. So I want you people to tell me if there was any change in the language, if the image was a bit different. I mean, not related to it. Okay, the image will be different, but if it is related to that particular image, that is okay. Okay, and any question, if it is apart from the questions which I have, if there was any other question which was asked related to the surgery. Okay, hi Siddharth, good evening. Okay, so let's see the questions, and I need your continuous input into these questions, so that we can frame the question as close to possible which was asked in the original exam. Okay, so let's see the first question. Following image in the limb is the result of involvement of. You can see this is the affected limb. Okay, this is the limb which is showing lymphedema. Okay, so this is a typical lymphedema picture. It is not because of arteries, veins or the DVT. It is involvement of lymphatics. Okay, so this is lymphedema because of the blockage of the lymphatics, which can be congenital, it can be because of certain infections like filariasis, it can be seen post-surgery, post-radiation, this blockage of the lymphatics can be seen and that can lead to lymphedema. Yes, Anurag, you are correct, it is lymphatics. Okay, next question. A patient had road traffic accident, brought to the emergency with bradycardia and high BP. Okay, so bradycardia, hypertension and irregular breathing. This is Cushing's triad. Okay, this is Cushing's triad, which we'll see when the patient is having increased intracranial pressure. So this is a patient of head injury with GCS 6/15. Okay, so if the GCS is 8 or less than 8, this is the indication of intubation. Prophylactic endotracheal tube intubation. That should be the immediate management. Immediate management is intubation and ventilation. Okay, yes, this is head injury and the patient needs intubation and ventilation because the GCS is low. Okay, later on you can start the treatment and you can get the CT scan and then you'll know that what kind of injury it is and accordingly you will treat. But initial management is because the GCS is low, this is a severe head injury and you need to intubate the patient. Yes, very good, Shavinder, Siddharth, intubation. Next question, again, there were lots of questions from the trauma. Okay, so this is, every time I say trauma is one of the most important topic of these days, all these exams, the focus is on trauma, malignancies. Okay, so next question, maxillofacial trauma, intubation of choice. See, in case of head injury and all, oropharyngeal intubation is correct. Maxillofacial trauma, also oropharyngeal intubation should be attempted. But most of the time, because of the, you know, fractures of the fragment and also there is bleeding which will not allow the vocal cords to be seen when you try to intubate the patient. Okay, so in all these cases, a surgical airway is preferred. Okay, so that's why tracheostomy is the answer. Okay, tracheostomy is the answer. Nasopharyngeal intubation is not done. Okay, nasopharyngeal intubation will not be possible in these cases. Maxillofacial trauma, there can be fracture of the, you know, cribriform plate, there can be fracture of the maxilla, mandible. In all these cases, intubation is not successful. Mostly, if it is possible to easily intubate, then you can do it, but looking at the question, intubation of choice, and they have specifically mentioned maxillofacial trauma, surgical airway would be the laryngeal mask airway. Shavinder, is not a definitive airway. Okay, laryngeal mask airway we use in certain cases like elective surgeries when the surgery is for not long duration, 1.5 hours, like laparoscopic cholecystectomy and all. So laryngeal mask airway is never used in trauma. It will not prevent the risk of aspiration because it is not a definitive airway. Okay, so laryngeal mask airway is not used. Okay, tracheostomy is the answer here. Next question, triage. Match the most appropriate answer. Moribund or dead patient is black. Immediate intervention required for red patients. Okay, like airway obstruction, tension pneumothorax, massive bleeding. Green patients are ambulatory patients. Okay, they are ambulatory patients and they are not our priority. Walking wounded patients. So they don't need any early intervention. Now, yellow colored patients, they are those who need hospitalization or observation, but there is no immediate threat to life. Okay, in yellow, there is no immediate threat to life. They have injuries which needs hospitalization, which needs observation, but no immediate threat to life. Okay, so that's why looking at the option, this appears to be the most correct answer, because the other three are absolutely wrong. Okay, yes, stimulus. A man is working in an industry without wearing helmet and the hammer fell from his hand onto the head of the other person and working who is working on the lower floor and who suffered this kind of injury. I am not sure whether the x-ray was given or this 3D CT image was given, but looking at the nature of the injury, there is a hammer which is fell on the head of the another person from a floor, and now this will lead to a depressed kind of fracture. Okay, so this is a depressed fracture. Depressed fracture means when the depth of the fracture is more than the thickness of bone. Okay, depth of fracture is more than the thickness of that bone. In reverse triage, there is nothing like color. Okay, in reverse triage, the basic thing in the reverse triage is, Siddharth, that when there is inflow to the patient in the hospital, when there are like so many people are coming to the hospital, you need to start discharging the patient who are not actually in need of the hospitalization, who are not very sick, who are not in ICU. You can start discharging those patients, like elective surgery patients who actually don't need that, 24-hour observation. So you can discharge those patients to accommodate the patients who are coming to your hospital. Yes, depressed structure, correct, stimulus. Okay, next question. A patient was brought to the emergency following a road traffic accident. He suffered from EDH, extradural hematoma, which occurs because of the lateral impact on the head. Okay, lateral impact. Okay, when there is injury in this temporal area. Okay, so that is terion. Okay, terion, the vessel which is injured is middle meningeal artery. So this is a hematoma which is formed between the skull and the dura mater, and this middle meningeal artery runs in this area, terion, and that's why when the injury occurs in this area, middle meningeal artery, the terion is the area. Okay, so this should be like very up to this. There is no confusion, no controversy, nothing. Terion. Yes, correct, stimulus. Next question, a patient suffered from, trauma, brought to the emergency. GCS was E2M4V2, that is GCS is 8. CT shows the following image. See, you can see on the CT, there is a biconvex hyperdense area. Okay, so biconvex or lens-shaped hyperdensity. That is EDH. Preferred treatment in this patient. Now see, conservative treatment for 6RC, looking at the site or size of the hematoma, and you can see there is midline shift also in this area. Midline shift, GCS is low, severe head injury. Okay, so no conservative treatment. Anticoagulation is not going to help in this patient. Ventilation is, yes, required. Patient needs endotracheal intubation. But the question is the preferred treatment. So if they ask initial treatment, then yes, ventilation or intubation is there. But the preferred treatment is you have to do a craniotomy and evacuation of hematoma. Initially, you can do a Bahl craniotomy, but the definitive treatment is you do a craniectomy and evacuate the hematoma. Okay, craniectomy and evacuate the hematoma. That is the best thing you can do in these patients. Okay, so initial, or if they ask if there was like initial management, or they ask the next step, then the answer would have been ventilation. But they asked preferred treatment. Okay, so means they are asking about the what is the definitive treatment you will do in these cases. So that's why it is how to determine the volume of what you are asking, volume of oxygen to administer to a patient. Volume of oxygen means initially when the patient comes, we'll start the oxygen at approximately 6 to 8 liters per minute. Okay, and depending on the requirement, depending on the saturation of the patient, that can alter. It can go up to like 15 liters per minute, also 10 liters. Okay, so that depends on the requirement of the patient. Okay, Ravi Prasad, which fluid is used most commonly during intraoperative blood loss? Okay, so when intraoperative blood loss occurs, first we'll give crystalloid like Ranger's lactate or normal saline. And if crystalloid is also not helping out, then definitely yes, blood transfusion should be given. Blood transfusion should be started. Okay, so they are asking most commonly used intraoperative blood loss, and the only crystalloid option here is normal saline. Normal saline. So when the bleeding occurs during surgery, immediately you start pushing the fluid, you call for the blood, and the moment you get the blood, you start giving blood to the patient. Okay, if the fluid is suppose you start the fluid, now you control the bleeding, parameters of the patient are fine, then you don't have to give blood in those cases. Okay, so blood is not always required, but yes, if your crystalloids are not maintaining the blood pressure, you can start with blood. And suppose there is some problem, the blood is not available, or the cross matching is not done, and now it is taking time, and the patient's BP is dropping. In those cases, till you get the blood, you can give colloids also. Okay, if the patient is not maintaining the blood pressure, blood is not in hand, you can give colloids like Hess and other colloids for a brief period. Okay, so crystalloid, that is normal saline, should be the answer in this case. Next question. Okay, patient presented with again trauma, brought to the emergency, there is tachycardia, there is hypotension, IV fluids was given, blood transfusion was also given, but nothing is helping out the patient. You open up the patient and you will see profuse amount of bleeding, and now there was a liver bleeding, there was bleeding from liver, and this maneuver was done where the surgeon put his left hand and he'll compress this part. This is the hepatoduodenal ligament. In this hepatoduodenal ligament, the portal vein, hepatic artery, and bile duct is running. Okay, so the moment you will compress this, you are occluding the inflow to the liver and most of the bleeding stops. This maneuver is Pringle's maneuver. This maneuver is Pringle's maneuver. Then they ask question, even after Pringle's, if the bleeding continues, if bleeding continues from the liver, then what is the source of bleeding? Then the answer is hepatic vein. Mattox maneuver is left medial visceral rotation. Left medial visceral rotation. If you want to go to the aorta or the kidney, left kidney, you will do Mattox. Kettle brush is right medial visceral rotation for IVC or right kidney. And Cocker's maneuver is duodenal mobilization. Okay, yes, you are correct, Siddharth. It is Pringle's maneuver. Okay, next question. A patient whose kidney stones were removed earlier presented after 2 years with complaints of fever and flank pain. Imaging done, and which is shown this. Okay, so you can see in this image there is a retained DJ stent. This is a DJ stent, double J stent, which is retained. Okay, so 2 years back when the surgery for the kidney stone was done, that time the DJ stent was put, and now it is, we give the instructions to the patient that get it removed after, around 3 to 4 weeks later, this DJ stent should be removed by the cystoscopy. If the stent is persistent there, it can lead to stone formation, it can lead to infection, and this is what is happening to the patient. Okay, fever and flank pain. So probably patient is having this pyelonephritis, and this is the source which is present inside. This DJ stent should be removed. Okay, and you can remove this by cystoscopy. Okay, so one end of the DJ stent is present in the bladder, so you can do the cystoscopy, catch hold of the stone and take it, catch hold of the DJ stent and take it out. Okay, so this is what we do. This is the answer in here, cystoscopic retrieval of the foreign body. This foreign body is actually DJ stent. Next question. Okay, patient has been treated for burns 5 years back and now he has developed an ulcer burn 5 years back. And there is an ulcer in the burn scar. So this is the area where the burn had occurred. And now patient is having this lesion. So this is from a long-standing burn, from a long-standing scar, venous ulcer, malignancy may arise. And that malignancy is known as Marjolin's ulcer. Okay, so this is Marjolin's ulcer. Yes, stimulus, correct. This is Marjolin's ulcer. See, venous ulcer, the area will be on the medial. This is the site they have shown is the lateral aspect. Venous ulcer occurs at the, the medial aspect, the gator area. Arterial ulcer is usually seen in the foot, in the plantar aspect. Deep vein thrombosis generally does not produce ulcer. Okay, so this is very typical. There is history of burns, there is a scar, and there is a ulcer arising from that, a long-standing scar that is clear-cut Marjolin's ulcer. Yes. Next question, what is the preferred site of insertion of intercostal tube drain? Okay, suppose these are the ribs. Okay, so suppose this is the second, third, fourth rib. So just under the ribs, intercostal neurovascular bundle runs. So when you are putting a ICD, you have to go between the two ribs. So when you are going between the two ribs in the intercostal space, you have to go in this area. Okay, you have to go from this area, that is, you can see just above the lower rib. Okay, just above the lower rib. Suppose this is the rib. So you have to go in this area. Okay, fifth intercostal space, fourth or fifth intercostal space, just anterior to mid axillary line is the preferred side. Okay, so you can say that it is option number 3, upper border of lower rib. Yes, stimulus, correct. Fifth intercostal space, upper border of lower rib. Yes, Lohitha. A patient after road traffic accident suffered from chest trauma, tube thoracostomy done. Okay, so there is chest trauma for which a ICD was placed. ICD was placed for, you can say, looking at the question, there was hemothorax, and now it drained 1800 ml of blood in 1 hour. Okay, so after ICD, either there is more than 1500 ml of blood comes immediately, or there is more than 200 ml of blood coming every hour for 2 to 4 consecutive hours. So this patient, the drainage is 1800 ml. This is massive hemothorax. There is some ongoing bleed, and for that you have to open up the patient and do an emergency thoracotomy. Emergency thoracotomy. Okay, hemostatic agent, stimulus. No hemostatic agent. It is not going to help. Okay, either you do ICD, and if after ICD the blood, initial blood, whatever, suppose it comes less than 1500, then you have to see after initial evacuation how much blood is coming every hour. And if it is less than 200 ml, you can wait and watch. In the meantime, you can give blood if the patient is having hemodynamically unstable or pallor. Otherwise, if the blood is more than 200 ml per hour, means there is some active bleeding. Or more than 1500 ml initial blood, that is massive hemothorax. In both these cases, you have to open up the patient and control the bleeding. Okay, hemostatic agent will definitely not going to correct this patient. Okay, yes, Lohita, you are correct. Next question. Early diabetic with extremely painful blister, woody surface. Now, I don't know whether image was given or not. You let me know whether there was any image or not. Okay, so if there is a painful woody surface in the limb, that goes in favor of necrotizing fasciitis. Necrotizing fasciitis. Gas gangrene, there will be crepitus. There will be crepitus. Now, cellulitis can also be seen, but in cellulitis, usually the woody surface and blisters are not seen. DVT, there is no risk factor as such of the DVT which is given. Okay, so if there was an image given, then looking at the image, we can differentiate that whether it was necrotizing fasciitis or cellulitis. Okay, there was no image, Lohita. Looking at this sentence, it looks like a necrotizing fasciitis. Okay, extremely painful woody surface, that hard skin, woody skin you will see in necrotizing fasciitis. Next question, there was a device like this is given. Okay, so this is a handheld Doppler. Handheld Doppler. Okay, so this handheld Doppler can be used for the peripheral vascular disease patient. Okay, with the help of this, we can measure the systolic blood pressure. Okay, we can check the ankle brachial pressure index. Okay, so this is the better answer. Although it can check, you can check the thickness of the artery vein also. This is also partially correct. It can check the localized calcified plaque also. This is also partially correct. But the best answer here should be measure the systolic blood pressure at the ankle, and then you can calculate the ABPI with this. Okay, if this is the image, which of the following is correct? This is the best answer. Measure the systolic blood pressure. This is the handheld Doppler. Okay, so in ABPI, when you measure the blood pressure in the in ABPI, you measure the blood pressure, maximum systolic pressure, you will check maximum systolic blood pressure at the ankle, where you will check the blood pressure in the anterior tibial artery, posterior tibial artery and peroneal artery. Dorsalis pedis, posterior tibial and peroneal, and in denominator, max systolic blood pressure at arm. Okay, so for this, you need this handheld Doppler. Okay, a patient presenting with varicose vein, as shown in the image, what is the investigation of choice? Straightforward, this is, okay, venous duplex or Doppler image. Okay, this duplex is nothing but Doppler with B-mode ultrasound. So, duplex imaging. These days, only this image is good enough. You don't need to do any MRI or flebography or plethysmography. These kind of investigations are not done these days. If you are suspecting a varicose vein or a DVT, venous Doppler or duplex is the... Yes, stimulus, you are correct. Okay, if the question was which is incorrect, okay, so this will be incorrect. This will be incorrect. Okay, so this is a Doppler, a handheld Doppler. So, like I said, this is also partially correct. This is also partially correct. So, this is the incorrect, you know, the answer here. Okay, so it is not an infrared imaging. It is a venous Doppler. It is a handheld Doppler. So, that is the incorrect option. I have written in the question as which of the following is correct. So, those three options are correct. Incorrect will be one. Okay, so Karan and... Chetan, see, if it was correct, then 3 is the answer. If it was incorrect, then 1 is the answer. Okay, next question. Baby presenting with bilious vomiting in 2 days of the birth. X-ray is shown. So, this X-ray is showing a double bubble sign. Double bubble sign. Now, look at the options. In esophageal atresia, there will be no bubble. Pneumatosis intestinalis, there is basically, this is seen in cases like necrotizing enterocolitis, and you will see there is air in the wall of the intestine. That is not shown. It is just showing there is a stomach and duodenum, both are distended. Now, these two can be the possible answer. But pyloric stenosis, if you see infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, it usually presents after, you know, around 4 to 6 weeks of birth. And the question is 2 days. 2 days. So it will never present in the first week, second week. Okay, so that's why duodenal atresia is the answer. Duodenal atresia, yes, all of you are correct. Ravi, Lohita and Stimulus. Duodenal atresia is the answer. Next question, a lady presented with blood discharge from the nipple. On detailed evaluation, it was found to be a single lactiferous duct. So blood discharge from the nipple, single lactiferous duct, the age is not given. So the two probable diagnoses here is duct papilloma or duct ectasia. Okay, both these things can give a bloody discharge from the nipple. And looking at the option, what should be the treatment? Incision and breast support is not a option. It can may be done if there is an abscess, which is absolutely not there. Hatfield surgery is done when in the there is involvement of multiple ducts. Okay, if there is multiple duct dilatations, then you go for Hatfield's operation, in which you will remove the major ductal system, approximately 5 centimeters of the major ducts from the nipple areolar complex you will remove. Microdochectomy is the answer here because there is a single duct, so you'll remove approximately 2 to 3 centimeters of the major duct, that involved duct. Okay, on the day of surgery, you express, you will see which duct it is coming, and now you can put a lacrimal probe or you can put a dye, and you will give an incision and take out that involved duct. Okay, so microdochectomy is the answer. Microdochectomy is the answer. Gas used in laparoscopy, the most common gas used is carbon dioxide. Okay, it is straightforward, there is no confusion, very easy question. The most common gas used in the laparoscopic surgery is carbon dioxide. Bluish, translucent, extravasation cyst, sublingual, veins overlying the swelling, it is transluminant. All the things are going in favor of ranula. I don't know whether the image was there or not. Whether any image was there? Okay, Lohita, Stimulus, Ravi, Karan, Siddharth. Is there an image given in that? Ranula. Okay, next question. Just tell me, I have just these two options. 60-year-old male with frequency of micturition and voiding difficulty. Post-voidal residual urine is 160 ml. So, patient is having lower urinary tract symptoms. Okay, looking at the age of the patient, in this age group, the most common reason is BPH, benign prostatic hyperplasia. Which of the following will help in relieving the patient's symptoms? Okay, in BPH, initially we give medical management like alpha blocker, and it usually like selective alpha A blocker, tamsulosin, and these days alfuzosin, these drugs are given, and 5 alpha reductase inhibitor can be added if only alpha blocker is not useful. So then we can use finasteride or dutasteride. So looking at, I mean, if I have these two options, I'll go for 5 alpha reductase inhibitor. If you remember any other option in this question, any other thing which was there, okay, whether they had written TURP or any surgery was mentioned. Okay, Karan, fine. If there was only history, no image, then it was ranula. Okay, it is sure shot ranula. So can you help me in, you know, getting the other two options in this question? Patient, elderly patient, lower urinary tract symptom, it is BPH. Now, there was one option was 5 alpha reductase inhibitor. That is correct. That is given in the medical management. Beta blocker has no role. If there was any TURP given or any other medication was mentioned. TURP was there. Okay, let's write TURP. See, if the post-voidal residual urine is 160 ml, it is less than 200 ml, and given the patient had not taken any treatment yet, then also you will start the patient on the medical management. Surgery you will do if there is failure of medical management, when the patient is having severe symptoms, like when the IPSS score is more than 20 despite treatment, if it is causing back pressure changes like bilateral hydronephrosis, renal failure, recurrent UTI, massive, gross hematuria. In those cases, surgery is done. Surgery is not the first line treatment in BPH. Okay, so Lohita, even if it was BPH, the medications is still the best answer here. Next question, patient undergoing hernia surgery, Lichenstein. Whether any image was there of the Lichenstein hernia repair? Okay, Lichenstein is a meshplasty. Okay, so they have asked, mesh used in the operation is made up of which material? Okay, so the most common mesh we use for the open hernia repairs is proline or the polypropylene mesh. Polydioxanone is PDS. Okay, we don't use PDS mesh. Polyglycapron is the monocryl suture. Again, this is not used as mesh. Nylon is nylon. It is used as a suture, not used as mesh. So polypropylene is the mesh used. Okay, if it is a laparoscopic surgery, if it is a laparoscopic hernia repair, so in laparoscopic hernia repair, the mesh is going to be in contact with the abdominal viscera. And if you use a polypropylene mesh, it will cause adhesions with the abdominal contents, with the intestine. So that's why in these cases, you use a different type of mesh, composite mesh. Okay, in composite mesh, one, it is a bilayered mesh. One side is made up of proline only. Proline. And the another side, which is going to be in contact with the abdomen, that is made up of either polytetrafluoroethylene or oxidized regenerated cellulose. So these are the layers which are actually non-sticky layer. So if this layer is facing towards the intestine is not going to come and adhere to the mesh. Okay, so if it is a open hernia surgery, Lichenstein repair, you use polypropylene mesh. In laparoscopic hernia, you use composite mesh. Okay, composite mesh is a bit, costly as compared to a polypropylene mesh. Nerve injury where Siddharth, in which surgery? In the laparoscopic hernia repair, like when we do a TAPP or TP, the nerve injuries which can occur is anterior cutaneous nerve of thigh, lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh, femoral nerve, and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. Okay, if you are asking open hernia surgery, an ilioinguinal nerve, iliohypogastric nerve, and genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. Okay, so these are the nerves which are at risk of injury when you are doing a open hernia repair, and those were the nerves which are at risk of injury when you do the laparoscopic hernia repair. Okay, Siddharth, this is what you are asking. Then there was a question where it was written, I guess, that all abdominal organs are normal, CT of the abdomen is normal, and what is the most likely diagnosis? Okay, so acute hemorrhagic pancreatitis, if the patient is having acute hemorrhagic pancreatitis, CT cannot be normal. Okay, CT will show this, although in the initial 48 hours, the CT is not very good investigation in case of pancreatitis. If you want to get a CT done, get it done after 48 to 72 hours. That time you can see the changes. Okay, necrotizing fasciitis. Just tell me whether any image was there or not in this case, in this question. Okay, so somebody is saying like there was a, maybe there was a image shown where in the limb there was some necrotic area, some necrotic patches were there. Then the answer will be necrotizing fasciitis. Okay, so was there any image given in this question where all the abdominal organs are normal on the CT? I guess this was given. No image. Okay, Lohita, any option if you can remember? Lohita, Shri, if any option you remember. Otherwise, if I have these three options, then necrotizing fasciitis would be the answer, because in that case, abdominal organs are usually not affected. CT of the abdomen will appear normal. So necrotizing fasciitis would be the answer in that case. Next question, very easy, 6-year-old, presented with a swelling in the subhyoid region, which moves with the deglutition and protrusion of tongue. Okay, so it is very, very obvious that this patient is having thyroglossal cyst. Okay, swelling which moves with a protrusion of tongue, thyroglossal cyst. What should be the treatment? Cyst trunk surgery. Okay, Ramstedt surgery is done for infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Total or hemithyroidectomy is done for the thyroid disorders, maybe benign or malignant. Okay, so this is cyst trunk surgery. This is done for the thyroglossal cyst. We'll remove the cyst, we'll remove the whole thyroglossal tract, and at times we need to remove the central part of the hyoid bone. Otherwise, if you don't remove the whole tract, it can lead to recurrence later. Valgus Gunstock deformity. Karan, see, this is a question of orthopedics, but as far as I remember, this is because of the supracondylar fracture in the humerus when there is abnormal union or malunion, it will cause this Gunstock type of deformity. Okay, so if there is history of trauma 3 months back with the humerus fracture and the malunion, can lead to Gunstock injury, but don't quote my words. This is a pure orthopedics question. So I guess the orthopedic faculty is Dr. Tushar is there, and he will explain you looking at the language of the question what else was given in the question. Yes, this is what I said, Siddharth. Looking at what you are asking, it looks like a supracondylar fracture. Identify the pathology given in the image. You can see the CT scan. Okay, in this CT, this is the liver, vertebra, this is aorta, this is right kidney, and this one is left kidney, and which is fused in the center. So this is a horseshoe kidney. Now you need to tell me whether the CT was given or this IVP was given, which shows flower vase appearance or the hand joining sign. Okay, so whatever was given, both based on both these things, it is clear cut horseshoe kidney. Okay, in putty kidney you will see calcification in the kidney, and in hydronephrosis you will see that kidney, the size of the kidney will be enlarged and there will be dilatation of the pelvic helical system. Ectopic kidney, they will show that there is some abnormal location. Kidney may be present in the renal pelvis, or both the kidneys are on the same side, then that can be renal ectopia. Okay, next question. A elderly male developing difficulty in swallowing after 2-3 bites. Halitosis is there. Radiological intervention showed features of lobar pneumonia and consolidation. Okay, so the patient is having dysphagia. Patient is having halitosis. Okay, so lobar pneumonia and consolidation is seen because of the aspiration. Now, in case of Zenker's diverticula, see, when there is this Zenker's diverticula, which is a false diverticula because only the mucosa is herniating. So when the food is present in this part, food residue, this is undigested food, so that will give halitosis. Okay, and this part will compress the, when it is big, it will put pressure on the esophagus, and that will cause the dysphagia to the patient. And because it is happening in the upper part of the esophagus, so that's why after 2-3 bites of the meal, patient is having dysphagia, because now the diverticula is putting pressure on the esophagus, causing dysphagia. Lobar pneumonia and consolidation is because sometimes when the patient is like sleeping and the reflexes are not working, the content in this part can go into the lung, and small those things can lead to lobar pneumonia, consolidation, lung abscess can be seen. Okay, so this answer is pulsion diverticula. In ecclesia, Siddharth, in ecclesia, the problem is, see, there is very high pressure in the lower esophagus. In this part, there is very high pressure. Lower esophageal sphincter tone will be more than 35. Normally, it is around 26, 25, 10 to 25. It will be more than 35. So, there is increased pressure, and also there is, you know, absence of primary peristalsis. The peristalsis will be absent in this part of the esophagus because of the, you know, the lack of the ganglionic cells in the myenteric plexus. So, there will be absence of primary peristalsis. Okay, so in this case, in case of this, dysphagia can occur, halitosis can also occur, but this thing after 2-3 bites of the meal is going more in favor of the Zenker's diverticula. No problem, Karan. Pulsion diverticula is the most likely answer, because in ecclesia cardia, patient will eat. Maybe after eating for some time, he will have this problem when the esophagus gets distended. That time, the patient can have dysphagia. Okay, but in 2-3 bites, hey, 2-3 bites will not cause that much dilatation. In DES and nutcracker esophagus, there is hyperperistalsis. Okay, Siddharth, in none of these, all these are motility disorders. Ecclesia cardia is a hypomotility disorder where the peristalsis is not happening. And in nutcracker and diffuse esophageal spasm, those are hypermotility disorder where the peristalsis is happening with a vigorous contraction that is leading to pain and dysphagia to the patient. Any age beyond which one can't do surgery? There is nothing, Sukhbir, the age, there is no such age criteria beyond which you don't do surgery. Okay, you have to see what are the risks and benefits of doing that particular surgery. Okay, even if the patient is 95 year old, there is malignancy, I mean not prostate malignancy, but other malignancies, we do surgery in those cases. Okay, but suppose a patient who is like 95 year old, who is having a hernia, which is uncomplicated, then you don't do surgery in those cases. So it depends on that what surgery you are going to do and if the patient is having any comorbid condition. Okay, 85 year old healthy male, you can go ahead and do any surgery if he's healthy. Okay, so as such, there is no criteria. Okay, I'm asking about student myself. Okay, Sukhbir, so I guess this was your query, that any particular age, if there is any particular surgery you are asking, if you are asking about any particular comorbidity in that patient who is elderly, then you can specify. Yes, currently all many of those images of the DFX, what you are saying, so many direct questions from DFX. Okay, so yes, there are lots of all these questions. If you see the notes also, most of the questions are from the notes directly. In we did the revision also in the end DFX. Okay, what can be the likely diagnosis in a child of 3 to 5 years of age presenting with a 14 cm tender mass in the flank region? This is the age group. 2 to 5 years is the age group of Wilms tumor. And what is what are the clinical features? There is a lump, there is pain, there can be hematuria, there can be fever. Okay, all these are very typical of Wilms tumor. Hydronephrosis can lead to a mass, but it usually does not give pain. Angiomyolipoma is not seen in this age group. RCC is also not seen in this age group. Angiomyolipoma is a benign tumor. Usually, it does not become this 14 centimeter big. Renal cell carcinoma, again, this is not the age group. 3 to 5 years, very clear cut. Okay, there are so many hints. You just pick one hint and you will see the answer right in front of you. Which layer is absent in esophagus? See, in esophagus, mucosa is there, submucosa is there. Muscularis mucosa is also there. Muscularis propria is also there. But serosa is not there. Okay, instead of serosa, there is adventitia. Adventitia is there. So mucosa, submucosa, muscularis propria, adventitia, or the outer fibrous layer is present. Okay, serosa is absent in esophagus. Next question, image shown is suggestive of which pathology? Again, you can see this is in the shape of stomach. This is a hair ball, which is trichobezoar. Okay, this is a repeat question. There was a question that in trichobezoar, the patient should consult which other specialty doctor, and that time the answer was, a psychiatrist, because this occurs because of the psychiatric disorder, trichotillomania, in which the patient, they pluck their hair and they eat. Okay, so this is trichobezoar. Phytobezoar, there is this, vegetative material which is present in the stomach. And usually in those cases, we don't have to do surgery. You can do endoscopic fragmentation and you can give some enzymes to clear that vegetative material. Pharmacobezoar is seen in the, when there is, the medication, it forms a kind of lump in the abdomen. That is usually seen in those gastroparesis cases when the motility of the stomach is impaired. Yes, Rapunzel syndrome, Siddharth, is, looking at this, you will not say Rapunzel syndrome, because for Rapunzel syndrome, this hair ball should extend like this into the duodenum. Okay, if it is extending into the duodenum, then it becomes Rapunzel syndrome, duodenum or into the jejunum. So if the extension of this hair ball is going into the intestine, then you call it as Rapunzel syndrome, otherwise it is a trichobezoar. Next question, Billroth 2 surgery has been done and the patient presented with vomiting and diarrhea after 20 minutes. What will be the initial management? See, when you do the Billroth 2 surgery, in which you will do a side-to-side anastomosis between the stomach and the jejunum. So because now whenever the patient eats, the food will immediately go into the intestine. Because of this immediate, the food is reaching into the intestine. Otherwise, normally what happens? When you eat, the food, there is pyloric sphincter. So the food goes slowly through this pyloric sphincter into the intestine. So by the time it reaches into the intestine, the osmolarity of this food, which is high in the carbohydrate, gets better. But in this case, this high osmolar fluid immediately reaching into the proximal intestine. So this is known as dumping syndrome. Okay, now there are two types of dumping syndrome, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is one which is seen within like 15 to 30 minutes. That is fitting our question. That is because of that hyperosmolar fluid goes. So to make it isosmolar, there is lots of fluid enters into the intestine that will cause bloating. And, the patient can have features of hypovolemia, giddiness. Okay, so this is because of hypovolemia, fluid movement. And type 2 is when this food reaches into the intestine, there will be increased insulin secretion that will cause type 2 dumping syndrome, hypoglycemia. Okay, so in this dumping syndrome, what will be the initial management? Okay, so if this is like dumping syndrome, we ask the patient to take small frequent meals. We ask the patient to take low carbohydrate, high protein. The patient can take high fat also. Carbohydrate should be low, small frequent meals, avoid drinking between the meals. These are some of the things which will ask the patient to do initially. Octreotide can be given to the patient, and if all these conservative management is not helpful, then in those cases we might have to go for a roux and white type of gastrojejunostomy. Okay, yes, Siddharth, absolutely correct. Small frequent meals with low carbohydrate diet. Identify the needle given in the image. Okay, very clear cut. Okay, I'm sure all of you must have done this correct. This is a venous needle to start the pneumoperitoneum or the carboperitoneum in the laparoscopic surgery. Okay, spring-loaded needle. Okay, so this is a venous needle. Identify the pathology given in the image. Now, if you look at this image carefully, on this side, this is a plain X-ray, and you can see a very nice reniform type of image. So this is a kidney in which there is air present inside the renal parenchyma. Inside the renal parenchyma, when there is air, It is emphysematous pyelonephritis. Emphysematous pyelonephritis. In hydronephrosis, the kidney size will be enlarged, but you will not see air inside. PUJ obstruction again leads to hydronephrosis only. Okay, tuberculosis, you will see the putty kidney or the cement kidney that will be calcified. That will appear absolutely white. So this is emphysematous pyelonephritis. There is air in the renal parenchyma, and that is emphysematous pyelonephritis. Can be because of Clostridium infection. Sometimes these E. coli can also cause emphysematous pyelonephritis. Prognosis of a colorectal cancer depends. Best prognostic factor is lymph node involvement. Okay, so lymph node involvement is the most important prognostic factor in the colorectal malignancy. If the lymph nodes are involved, then we have to give chemotherapy also in those cases. Depth of invasion, yes, it is important, but looking at the best thing, it is lymph node involvement. Okay, Karan, did you mark depth of invasion for colorectal cancer? Lymph node involvement is the most important prognostic factor. Lymph node involvement is the most important prognostic factor. Next question. 20-year-old patient suffering from pain in the right iliac fossa for the last 5 days. Okay, young patient, right iliac fossa pain, it is appendicitis. But for the 5 days. So in these 3-4 days, what happens after 72 hours? All these omentum, the intestine, the mesentery, everything comes and forms a appendicular mass there. Patient is having fear and leukocytosis. What should be the management in this case? In appendicular mass, you should go for a conservative management, that is Ochsner-Sharon regimen, in which you will give antibiotics, IV fluid. You can keep the patient nil peroral for a few days. And later on, when this inflammation, this mass type is resolved, you can call the patient and do an interval appendectomy. Okay, if you go for appendicectomy at this time, it will be very difficult. There are chances that you might not be able to identify where the appendix is. And in this mass, when you go, you might cause injury to intestine or there can be excessive bleeding. So it is better you put the patient on Ochsner-Sharon regimen. Alvarado is a score. It is not a regimen. Okay, Alvarado is a score used for acute appendicitis. Okay, no issues, Karan. There are lots of questions. I'm sure most of the questions you are doing correct. Just one or two wrong. It's okay. Elderly patient, dye industry, thickened irregular bladder wall, or if there was this mass which was invading the bladder. Okay, so this is carcinoma urinary bladder. Now there are two types. One is non-invasive. Non-invasive is when it is limited to the mucosa, it has not gone in the wall of the bladder, and invasive is when it goes in the wall of the bladder. So in invasive, you go for a radical cystectomy. In non-invasive, you can go for TURBT. After that, you will give some, either you can give intravesical chemotherapy or immunotherapy, depending on the nature of the tumor, the grading of the tumor, you can go for this. So if they are saying that the wall was irregular, or if it was invading the wall, means it is an invasive cancer. So for that, you have to go for a radical cystectomy. Okay, radical cystectomy. So now, Siddharth, you need to tell me, BCG is given if you are doing a TURBT. Now, I'm not saying that you marked the wrong thing. You need to tell me what was it showing. What was the question? Whether there was irregular bladder wall was given, or whether it was given that the tumor is invading the wall. So if it is invading the wall, then you have to go for radical cystectomy. If it was given that it is very superficial and it was not invading the wall, then TURBT and intravesical BCG could have been the answer. Okay, Siddharth. Otherwise, radical cystectomy should be the answer for an invasive bladder cancer. Next question. 70-year-old male complains of regurgitation in supine position. Difficulty in swallowing the solids. Elderly patient, dysphagia to solids. It is carcinoma esophagus. stomach cancer will cause bladder gastric outlet obstruction. Gastric outlet obstruction. In aplasia cardia, initially there will be dysphagia to the liquids. Later on, it can be dysphagia to solids also. GERD is usually you will there is no complaint of as such dysphagia until unless it is a later stage when there is stricture formation and the other thing occurs, and also the age also goes in the favor of malignancy. Age also goes in favor of malignancy. Yes, stimulus, correct. It is cancer esophagus. Next question. Anemic man who is a smoker for his concern regarding his fatigue as his sister has. So the patient is concerned because her his sister is she had endometrial cancer, which should screening should be used for colorectal malignancy. Okay, so for colorectal malignancy, flexible sigmoidoscopy is not done yearly. It should be done like 5 to 10 years. Colonoscopy every 10 years is correct. Barium enema is also, you know, people use double contrast. Double contrast means contrast and air. Barium enema, that also done 5 to 10 years. Not a very good treatment option. Occult stool blood can also be a answer. Okay, fecal occult blood test can be done. Okay, but in this case, one very, very clear, very obvious answer is colonoscopy every 10 years. Okay, they have given colonoscopy. They have also mentioned the correct frequency or the duration when this should be repeated. Every 10 years, you get the colonoscopy. Fecal occult blood test you should do yearly. Flexible sigmoidoscopy can be done 5 yearly. Okay. All are true about papillary thyroid cancer except it is TSH dependent. That is true. Serum thyroglobulin is a tumor marker. That is true. Most common. It is also true. Arise from parafollicular cells is very false. Parafollicular cells, medullary thyroid cancer occurs. So it was a very easy question. Very easy question. Everybody marked it correct. Next, thyroid malignancy with raised serum calcitonin and serum CA. Now you just tell me whether both the questions are there or like there was just one question on this. Okay, serum calcitonin and CEA is medullary thyroid cancer. Okay, so both the questions were there. Lohitha, Siddharth, these both were there or only one was there, and now based on the recall we have formed two different questions. Okay, because both, if both are there, believe me, both are one of the easiest question in the exam. If you have ever read about thyroid malignancy, you cannot make these two questions wrong. Okay, Mufti, Rashid, if it was there, then I'm sure you must have marked it correct. Lady with ERPR positive, HER2 negative, signet ring cells will present E-cadherin negative. Okay, so if E-cadherin expression is not seen, it will be a lobular cancer. Okay, loss of E-cadherin expression. Loss of E-cadherin expression. It will be lobular carcinoma. Okay, if there was any other information given, if there was any other thing was there, just let me know. Otherwise, looking at this, 90% of the lobular carcinomas are ERPR positive. 90% of these are ERPR positive. 75% of the ductal, invasive ductal cancers are ERPR positive. Except medullary carcinoma, which is only 10% ERPR positive. Most of the cancers are ERPR positive. Lady presented with redness and podiorange appearance involving more than 2/3 of the breast. Without any palpable lump. So if there is podiorange appearance involving more than 2/3, if it is more than 1/3 of the breast involvement, no palpable lump, it is inflammatory breast cancer. And inflammatory breast cancer in the TNM staging goes directly to T4D. T4A is chest wall involvement. T4B is skin involvement. Means ulcer, satellite nodules, or this podiorange, which is not fitting in inflammatory cancer. Poly or angiopoietin not fitting in inflammatory cancer. Okay, so that's why this question, this poly or angiopoietin is fitting in inflammatory cancer. So that's why it is not skin involvement, it is inflammatory cancer. Now tell me who did this question correct. Okay, Lohita, did you mark this correct? Karan, Rashid, Stimulus, Siddharth, have you marked this question correct? Inflammatory breast cancer, T4D. Now, these questions are, I'm not sure whether it was there or not there. Delayed wound healing after surgeries due to vitamin C is important for the wound healing. Okay, iron, vitamin C, these are important things in the wound healing. Yes, medic, you have done 4B. Okay, Karan, if it was exactly like this, more than 2/3, then it is inflammatory cancer. Medic, yes, good, you have marked a very nice answer. Lohita, never mind. Okay, one or two questions here and there is not an issue. Okay, you have to get just 50% marks. So I'm sure all of you get. Okay, so if this question was there, vitamin C is the answer. Now, aortic dissection, which of the following structure involvement is involved in hiccups? Hiccups occurs when there is irritation to the phrenic nerve. And when aortic dissection is reaching up to the, you know, aortic hiatus in the diaphragm, then it can irritate the phrenic nerve, which can lead to hiccup formation. And lots of teachers are not aware. Okay, this is T4. If the question was exactly like this, it is T4D. Yes, Rashid, you are correct, phrenic nerve. Now, this question also, I'm not sure whether there was an image shown of melanoma. Okay, there was an image shown in which there was a, you know, a black colored skin flat lesion is shown, which is irregular, variegated appearance. Okay, if it was there, the answer is melanoma. Okay, yes, thank you, medic. If you believe me in this question, I'm glad. Next question, manhole with a bulbar urethral injury, where urine will be collected? Okay, bulbar urethral injury is typical because of the manhole or the straddle injury, straddle or fall astride injury. So that causes injury to the anterior urethra. Okay, bulbar urethral injury is the anterior urethra, and in anterior urethral injury, the blood will collect in the superficial perineal pouch. Superficial perineal pouch. Urine dribbling will not see in any of the, it is not seen in urethral injury. Urine dribbling is seen in, you can say, when there is, you know, ectopic ureter, or when there is, you know, the sphincter is weak. In those cases, you can see the dribbling. Perivesical space, you can see the urine will collect if there is membranous urethral injury. Membranous urethral injury is, membranous urethra is the posterior urethra, and there the injury, the urine collects around the bladder. Another option was abdominal wall. See, abdominal wall is, if you are saying that, another option is abdominal wall. Then also, if there is superficial perineal pouch or if there is a perineal space, that is a better answer. If there is, the option is like perineal area, because it will cause a butterfly type of hematoma, and the urine will also extravasate in that area, that is also, that option is correct. If superficial perineal pouch was not there, then abdominal wall could have been the answer. Okay, Rashid. Now this question, again, I'm not sure. Hypertension with headache. So this is basically pheochromocytoma. What is the imaging modality to diagnose? Giving these options, see, if there was MRI in the options, then that would have been the answer. If MRI was there, there is a patient of pheochromocytoma. If they ask what is the best modality, or if they ask what is the investigation of choice, then MRI is the answer. Suppose MRI was not there. MIBG is used, but it is used when both the CT and MRI, they fail to diagnose or fail to localize the pheo. System EB is used for hyperparathyroidism. Okay, so MIBG is used after CT and MRI are failed to diagnose. Otherwise, initial management is CCT. Okay, initial investigation to diagnose is CT. After that, you can go for MRI. After that, you go for MIBG. Okay, so this is a sequence in which you will try to localize a pheochromocytoma. PET CT was there. Okay, nice. PET is not an answer. Okay, PET is not an answer. Okay, so now, Rashid, let's see your option. If you are saying MRI, if MRI was there, this is the answer. If it was not there, then CT is the answer. Okay, so now MRI is there. Mithu is also saying, Rashid is also saying. So considering that MRI was there, so we'll go for MRI as the best modality of diagnosis. Okay, if they had asked, best modality investigation of choice is this. Okay, best investigation of choice is this. If they asked what is the initial modality of choice, then it is CCT. CCT is the initial, overall best, and investigation of choice is MRI. Okay, so what was the exact language? Depending on that, the answer may vary. Okay, any other question? Any other question? If you remember, any other question? Anything else? Okay. Nadir, Mithu, Stimulus, Rashid, Siddharth, Lohitha. If there was any other question which I'm missing, please let me know so that we can, you know, discuss that also. Okay, so that's all, and I wish you best of luck for your, you know, the result. Most of the questions were easy, and I'm sure all of you have done extremely well in your exam, and be like, I'm keen to meet all of you after the exam comes, after the result comes. Okay, Karan, definitely you will get, I'm very sure that you will pass with flying colors. Okay, my best wishes to all of you, and may God be with you in your upcoming result. And also, this is just the beginning. Later on, you know, you have to crack PG also, and your preparation is more than 70% you are prepared for the PG. So after the exam, just, you know, we can go towards the next, you know, the goal in the life. Okay, so thank you very much, and wish you all the very best. God bless you all.